And welcome to module 2 of our little series about golf croquet. In this module we're going to be looking at some of the shots you can play and how to hit balls away, how to run hoops, and some of the faults that you might commit inadvertently, hopefully, when you're actually striking the ball. In golf croquet there is a much more limited range of shots that you need to use than in association croquet. Basically, it's the drive shot and the stun shot. And the drive is very simple indeed. In fact, it's the shot that we looked at in module 1. Here is the ball. I want to hit it fairly powerfully towards another ball, perhaps. And so I stalk it, line it up, swing the mallet, and just follow through. I hope you noticed that I kept my head down whilst I was playing the shot. There is a saying in croquet, head down and hear it hit, head up and watch it miss. And if you raise your head, and it's perfectly natural to do so, everybody wants to know that their shot is actually going to hit the ball that they're playing or the hoop that they're running. So it's natural to look up as you hit the ball. You must not. Keep your head down and play straight through it. If you bring your head up, your shoulders come with it and the mallet comes with it. And so you will end up topping the ball or missing it altogether. So keep your head down at all times. So how does a game begin? Well, as in many other games, we begin by tossing a coin. And if I was playing Charmian, because my handicap is the lower one, I would do the tossing and she would do the calling. So, would you like to call her?
Heads.
It is a tail. So, Charmin has lost the toss, which meant, of course, that I won the toss, and the person who wins the toss must start. There is no choice. So, if you win the toss, you have blue and black balls. If you lose the toss, you have red and yellow balls. Unlike association croquet, where there are balk lines and yard lines and certain rules about where you can start, golf croquet is completely different. In golf croquet, the starting place is in corner 4, distant from hoop 1, and it's in a quadrant, a yard from the corner of the lawn. So anywhere within that quadrant, mapped out by my mallet handle there. And I put the ball anywhere in that quadrant and then aim to shoot across the lawn towards hoop 1. And hoop 1 is the one with the blue top. So, as before, we step back, line up carefully, stalk the ball, swing the mallet, keeping your head down. So now it's my opponent's turn, and she is also going to play across the lawn to hoop 1. So here we are after the first turn, after all the balls have been played into the game. Blue, red, black and yellow have ended up here, and it's now blue's turn again, and blue can do various things, put the ball in front of the hoop, knock opponents away, promote his own ball, and so on. And eventually we'll get to a situation where one of these four balls is able to run the hoop. So here we are now, we've had a few more turns, black is straight in front of the hoop, and it's my turn to play. So as before, stalk the ball, swing the mallet, play gently through the hoop, and away she goes down towards hoop 2. And all the other balls now follow suit, playing down towards hoop 2. Some people think that they have to pick up their balls and walk. They don't. You play the balls from wherever they stand. So it would now be yellow's turn to play. So yellow, not my ball, but I'll play it. So yellow now plays down towards hoop 2.
bad shot, and blue and red follow on.
So the game carries on with players playing their balls in order until someone has scored seven hoops. If at the end of 12 hoops the scores are equal, six each, we play a 13th hoop, which is hoop three, which is the one opposite hoop one, and you play it with the balls on the far side. Although most games are 13 pointers, in other words twice round the lawn and hoop three again, it is possible to play a shorter game with only seven hoops, so that's once round the lawn, hoops one to six, and then again hoop three. And it's also possible to play a longer game with 19 hoops, so after hoop 12 you go around the circuit once more and then again finish at hoop three if necessary. So now we're going to talk about relative distances when you're hitting balls away from the hoop. Earlier on we looked at drive shots and stun shots and how in a stun shot the striker's ball will stop fairly quickly but the other ball will travel some distance. And one of the things you've got to understand in golf croquet is the relative distances that each of the two balls will travel when hit in a certain way. So here is a red ball which is perhaps threatening at the hoop and I'm going to hit it away and I'm hoping that my blue ball will end up somewhere in front of the hoop. And it's simply a question of hitting it with the right amount of power that makes the striker's ball end up in a reasonable place. I've got rid of the red ball, which has gone virtually over towards hoop four, and my blue ball is still in a threatening position to try and run this hoop on another turn. This is a fairly typical golf croquet situation. The red ball is fairly close to the hoop and could run it. My ball, the blue ball, is a little further away and, well, I think I'd be struggling to run that hoop. So it's now my turn. What I'm going to do is to do a stun shot which will put the red ball somewhere over there and hopefully leave my blue ball here in a position where it could run the hoop on the next turn. And all I do here is to literally stop the mallet as it's about to hit the ball. So I've stalked it, swing the mallet. And here is the blue ball, and it's in a hoop running position. The red ball is well out of the way. Actually, it's under the camera, so you can't see it. Here is another typical situation. The red ball's in front of the hoop, and could run it. Here's my blue ball, and this time I'm going to hit the red ball away to get rid of it. And this will be, again, another stun shot. And the red ball will probably go off the lawn. So I hit my opponent's ball off the lawn, and I'm going to retrieve it for her. So it went off there, just marking it with the mallet. But it went into the long grass, and I'm putting it back on the line. Now, golf croquet is different from association croquet because in association, a ball that goes off the lawn comes back onto a yard line. In golf croquet, there is no such thing as a yard line, and it comes back onto the actual boundary line. The question is, what is the boundary? Here is a white line. Is this the boundary, or is that the boundary? Well, in both forms of croquet, the boundary is the inside of the white line. Imagine a vertical wall on the inside of the white line, and that is the boundary. Now, in golf croquet, a ball is out when more than half of it is over that imaginary line. Now, this ball, there's the center. This ball would still be in if it was there. If it would be there, it would be out. And it's important to remember that. In fact, in golf croquet, it doesn't often happen that balls fall so closely on the boundary because they're normally hit fairly hard. They're either off or on. But that is the rule. So when a ball comes back onto the boundary, after it's gone off, as that one did, it comes back with half of it in and half
half of it out, as it were, right on the line.
I know that the skills of golf croquet, some would say the skill of golf croquet, is, of course, running hoops. If you can't run a hoop, you won't score points, so you won't win games. And so the ability to run the hoops from all sorts of angles is fairly important. But the important thing also is to understand your own limitations. Some people can run hoops from perhaps 10 feet away. Other people need them to be 10 inches away. And being in front of a hoop rather than on the wrong side of a hoop adds to the pressure on the opponents. So if possible, generally speaking, it's a good idea to try and keep your balls in front of the hoop rather than taking speculative shots which put the ball beyond the hoop having missed and therefore take pressure off the opponents. So here we are, we have a blue ball in front of a hoop which is, what, 4 feet away? And I reckon that's within my hoop running compass and I don't think I'd have too much bother deciding that I was going to run that hoop like that. The difficulty comes when instead of being perhaps 4 feet from the hoop, I'm now 10 feet from the hoop and I've got an opponent ball in a very nice hoop running position. What do I do? Do I try and run the hoop or do I get rid of the opponent ball? Ian's first rule of golf croquet is if you have an opponent ball in front of a hoop in a hoop running position, get rid of it. Because my chances of running the hoop from that distance are perhaps 40%, whereas I can pretty well guarantee getting rid of this red ball and giving myself another chance. And if I do a reasonable shot, I would probably leave my blue ball with a hoop running chance next turn. So, if you find yourself in this position, unless there's a very, very good reason to do otherwise, always get rid of the opponent ball. So how do I run a hoop? Well, actually, it's exactly the same as hitting a ball. Imagine that instead of a hoop, there's a ball there, and all you've got to do is to hit it in the middle. And so you stalk the ball, line it up carefully, keep your head down, and hit the ball as the mallet is coming upwards. And the upward movement of the mallet puts a little bit of topspin on the ball, which carries it through the hoop in case there's any chance of it stopping at all. So that was running a hoop with a straight ball. When it's angled from the hoop, it's a little bit more complicated, but not very much. The important thing here to recognize is that when the ball is coming up to the hoop, if it hits this upright, they're usually called wires, by the way, because in the olden days, croquet hoops were made of wire. They are no longer. If it hits this wire, it will bounce off. If it hits this wire on the opposite side, it will bounce through. And so what you've got to make sure of is that you just miss the near wire and that the centre line of the ball is in the hoop, as it were. If the centre line of the ball is outside the hoop, the ball will again bounce away. So running it through the hoop is really, really fairly straightforward. In order to do that, many people find it helpful to put their mallet alongside the ball. Now you must be very careful that you don't touch the ball because that would be a fault. But you can put your mallet alongside the ball and just sight along it so that the ball is going to run down that line and then just come along stalking, pick up your mallet, again not touching the ball. As with everything else, running hoops is a question of practice and to some extent confidence. If you think you can run a hoop, you probably will run that hoop. If you think this is difficult, you'll probably miss. And one of the little drills you can use in order to help build your confidence is simply hit a ball through a hoop and come round the other side, wherever it stops, and hit it back again. And carry on doing that.
until you get fed up.
It's a very nice little drill for giving you a bit of practice in building confidence and hitting hoops, running hoops, with very little fuss and bother. As in any other game, golf croquet has its rules, and they're set out in this little book, the World Croquet Federation Rules of Golf Croquet, and this is the fourth edition, March 2014. And it contains not only the rules, but also some commentaries by the Croquet Association on how the rules can be interpreted or should be interpreted. And in addition to those commentaries in here, there are further commentaries on the CA website, which are updated from time to time, and any changes in the rules themselves, so that you can keep up to date with the rules. And we're going to look at various of the rules in the book during these modules, but not all of them, because that would take far too long. And I'm going to begin with striking faults, rule 13. And rule 13 has no less than 15 clauses to it, which define various types of striking fault. And a striking fault is a fault which is committed between the mallet striking the ball and the striker, the person holding the mallet, moving away under control. But what does that mean? Here is a little example, perhaps. I'm going to play yellow onto black to get black away, but you notice that the blue ball is very close to my left foot. And I've got to be careful that things like the tabs on my shoes don't touch that blue ball, and also that during the striking operation, I don't accidentally touch it either, or until I've moved away under control. So here we go. So that would have been a striking fault. I accidentally hit the blue ball as I was striking the yellow ball. So that would have been a fault. What would happen now? Well, you've got to turn through the pages of Rule 13 to 13B, action after a striking fault. And if the fault has been noticed by the opponent after the stroke has been committed, or if you admit to having committed the fault, the opponent has the choice of leaving the balls where they are, or having them replaced before the fault was committed, in the place that they were before the fault was committed, and then the opponent plays. But if a hoop, for example, had been run, it would not count. No points are scored during a striking fault. The most obvious, in a way, striking fault is that you must not play before the previous turn has ended. In other words, that means before all the balls have come to rest in whatever position on the lawn. I am not allowed have my elbow on my knee. I am not allowed to rest the shaft of the mallet on the ground and do that. One that is perhaps a bit less obvious is that you must not touch the head of the mallet as you're striking the ball. There must be a gap between your hand and the head of the mallet. So if I held the mallet like that, for example, that would be a striking fault. I am not allowed to do that, for example. I must hold the mallet so that my hand is clear of the head. I am not allowed to use the side of the mallet. I must use the end faces, and only the end faces, and not the beveled edge of the mallet. Here is a typical situation where the ball has run through the hoop and it's rather difficult to get at it. What you may not do is to hold the mallet at this end and do that. Neither may you kick the mallet like that, and neither may you throw the mallet at the ball. Not that you'd want to, but you mustn't. A more usual situation is that if the ball is a little bit further through and you're wanting to get up to the next hoop, what you must not do here is to do a push shot. And a push shot is where basically the mallet is starting from rest and doing that. So the mallet is actually accelerating as it hits the ball. In that sort of situation, the best way is to put your hand through the hoop and punch the ball like that.
all fairly obvious and perhaps slightly extreme examples of striking faults, but they are in the rules, so have a look at them. Rule 13. Now, a less obvious striking fault is what's known as the double tap, where you hit a ball, probably inadvertently, twice in the one shot. And here is a typical situation. Here is a ball which is just lying outside the jaws of the hoop in line with one of the wires. And the usual thing will be to try and force that ball through the hoop. Let me just show you what tends to happen. That was almost certainly a double tap, because the ball bounced off the wire here, and as my mallet was going through, it hit it twice. Very difficult to see. So what you have to do in a situation like that, first of all, if there is any doubt that you're going to cause a double tap, call a referee, and the referee should mark the ball. And then if you're going to play it properly, you need to be very clear that you hit the ball cleanly and once, and there you are, it didn't go through. Because the first time through, I forced it through with the double tap. So you must be careful with those, and perhaps even warn your opponent that they are likely to do a double tap. So what's the penalty for a double tap? Well, if the fault is noticed before the opponent plays, then the opponent has the choice of either leaving the balls where they were or bringing them back to where the ball was at the start of the stroke in which the fault occurred. And then it's the opponent's turn to play. The other very common situation where a double tap can happen is if balls are close together, as here. These balls are separated by perhaps 4 or 5 millimetres. And research has shown that if balls are that close, it's highly likely that if I were to play the blue ball and follow through with the mallet, the blue ball would hit the red and the mallet would follow through and hit the blue ball twice. And so the general rule is that if you're in a situation like this where balls are close together and closer than 4 millimetres, then you should play the striker's ball, in my case the blue ball, at an angle of about 45 degrees so that there's no danger of it coming back onto the mallet. Here is another fairly common situation. My ball blue wants to run the hoop and it's touching the red ball. I can't really get my mallet in cleanly, and if I touch the red ball while I'm playing blue, that is a striking fault. So this, let's just show. And you may not have seen on the camera, but my mallet touched the red ball.
We recorded.
And so that was a striking fault. And so what would happen in that case, no hoop point is scored, and the opponent, the red ball's owner, has the choice of either leaving the blue ball there or putting it back to here. This is just one more typical example of a striking fault. My blue ball is actually more or less touching the upright, and it is a striking fault if the mallet, the ball and the upright are in contact at the same instant. So if I try and force this through, that was a crush, so that would have been a striking fault. What I should have done was to play it from this angle, which wouldn't have run the hoop, but it puts the ball cleanly in front. So that's the end of our second module on golf croquet. I hope you found it interesting. In the next module, we're going to be looking at some aspects of offside balls, wrong ball play, and aspects of tactical play.